My big actor voice now to reconvene us. I think we're on TV. Hello, How Round TV. So everything you say this afternoon can and will be used against you and broadcast nationally live. So just keep that in mind. It looks like many of you were here this morning, so thank you for staying with us for the full day. But we also have some new folks in the room too, and we welcome you.
Like a 30-second go-around? Yes. So let's just do a quick 30-second go-around, also just for all the new folks that are here to say who you are, and for folks on TV as well. So I'm Jeremy Cohen. I'm the Artistic Director here at the Playwright Center.
I am director of arts, culture, creative economy at the City of Minneapolis, also a member of Student Movement Collaborative Interdisciplinary Performance.
Lisa Channer, founder and artistic director at Peter Nobi Must.
Amy Rappelin,
our district director, Welcome Channel Theater Company.
Aditi Kapil, playwright in residence at Mixed Blood, poor writer at the Playwright Center, artistic associate at Park Square, and actor and director.
I'm Joe Octor, and I'm a playwright member of Workhouse Collective.
I'm Johnny Kiran Clara. I'm a playwright fellow here at the Playwright Center and writer and director of Public Space Group.
I'm Deborah Yarchin. I'm a Jerome Fellow at the Playwright Center.
Marian Musk, co-founder of Red Eye.
I'm Jessica Huang, I'm a playwright and co-founder and co-writer of the UN Collective.
Sarah Saltwick, a Jerome Fellow here.
Richard Cook, Artistic Director for Park Square Theater.
Christina Hamm, core writer, runner of the Many Voices program here at the Playwright Center.
I'm Elizabeth Deacon, I'm at the Guthrie Theater in the Marketing Department.
I'm Sina Hodges, I'm the Director of External Relations at Theater Latte Da.
Jamil Drew, producer in residence at Mixed Blood Theater, freelance director, playwright.
Alyssa Adams, I'm the director of New Play Development at Children's Theatre Company.
Jen Miller, I'm the producer at Children's Theatre Company.
Haley Finn, associate artistic director at the Playwright Center.
Kira Obolensky, playwright in residence at 10,000 Things.
Ron Russo, History Theatre, artistic director.
Anya Kamenetsky, artistic associate at History Theatre.
Dominic Orlando, I'm one of the founders of the Workhouse Playwrights Collective and a freelance playwright.
Dominique Serrault from the Moving Company.
Nathan Keepers from the Moving Company.
Randy Reyes, Artistic Director of Mu Performing Arts.
Mark Blankenship, online content editor of Theater Development Fund in New York City, and your scribe for the day.
I'm Brad Erickson. I'm the Executive Director of Theater of the Area, the service organization in the San Francisco area. I'm also a playwright.
I'm Tori Bailey. I'm the Executive Director of Theater Development Fund in New York City, which is our service organization.
So as we broke, we said that we would confer a little bit over lunch and figure out how we wanted to direct the afternoon, and we have now decided how we want to do that. We want to remind you all that what we're doing here, the three of us are doing here today, and joined by Jeremy, is we are really here to learn from you. The things that we're hearing in each city are really fascinatingly different, and so the things that we hear from you and that we'll learn today, we can't learn in LA on Monday, right? So there was a question of a little bit of like, what are we doing here today? And what we're doing here today is learning from you. Hopefully, it'd be great if you learned some things along the way today and leave with more than you came in with. But unfortunately, really, what's more important to us is that we learn from you. So just to put that on the table, because really all of this is, you know, we will be gathering all of these different perspectives and the stories and the anecdotes and the experiences that we've heard from around the country and compiling it and reconsidering it together. And we will be talking about ways that you can continue to be involved in the conversation with your peers who have been invited to these conversations in all of the six cities in an ongoing way. Mark will tell you more about that when we get to the end of the day. But again, to focus again, we are here madly taking notes, either physically or mentally, about what we're hearing and what we're learning from you. We wanted to loop back a little bit from where we started the conversation today and focus for just a little bit of this afternoon, and we've got 2 hours and that's it, because then we have to go catch a plane, on some of the data that we sent out, some of the research that we had commissioned. Specifically with the research that Alan Brown, working with from Wolf Brown, did, looking at some of the research that he did from the intrinsic impact work, the Theater of the Area Commission. Some of you all were involved with that work that we did. nationally. It started out with 18 theaters in 6 cities around the country. We followed it up with 30 more theaters in different cities around the country. We have literally collected tens of thousands of audience surveys, and that it is the raw data from those surveys that look into the way that the theater experience, performance, has moved an audience member. They're asked to fill out a survey within 24 hours of seeing the show on 30 or so different questions that look into the ways that an audience member is moved intellectually, emotionally, the way that they were caught up in the play, we call it captivation, the way that they were either bridged socially, which means that they were learning about it, a group of people that are different than yourself, or the way that you were bonded with sort of your own peeps. These are the sort of different things that we were looking at in 5 different categories and then measured. So that was a lot of the basis, along with work that Alan Brown had done at South Coast Rep in Orange County and with Steppenwolf in Chicago, that became the basis for the 26 or 27 page essay that hopefully many of you got a chance to read. We did not look specifically at new work. So Alan said, I think the closest thing that I can look at, we did do some work around risk and risky work. That's why there was that whole study that he did around risk, because that was the closest thing that we had to new work. Some of the work in the studies were new, but we weren't necessarily sorting for that. And Alan found what was to him some really surprising things. And so we wanted to kind of just review that a little bit, just now in 5 minutes maybe, and then hear from you about ways that you are experiencing that yourself, or the way that you think about your own making, and what the way you would maybe describe your community, your audience. So Alan describes, you know, audiences being on a spectrum. From risk averse, I do not want to go to something that is pushing my boundaries, to risk tolerant, like, no, all right, I'll be open to that, to risk seeking, which is like, I love that, I want to go do it, to the far end, which is, I actually want to be involved in some way in making the work itself. So that's the spectrum, right, that he posits. And that individual people sit somewhere along that line, and that work fits along that line. And it's not a good or bad thing. I mean, I think we have a real, I think we have a bias among theater makers, and you know, that the thing over on the far right, the riskiest possible, is good, and this other end is bad. And one of the things that Alan has found more and more in his work, that is what he used to call aesthetic growth, he's now calling aesthetic enrichment, which is that there's a reason why people keep going back to the Christmas Carol year after year, or to the Nutcracker, or to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. It's not bad, they're not dumb. People are wanting to reconnect with something that is meaningful to them. They're reconnecting to meaning. That is beautiful. And maybe that is really what your work is all about. New work could still be about reconnecting people to something that is meaningful already to them. That is not bad. It is just very different from something that is meant to kind of blow your head off, right? So where do you and your audience fit right now along that line is one thing that we'd like to be looking at. And where is your making? So let's just take that. The second question I'm going to ask, just to prepare you, is he also posited this idea and goes into research that has been done around learning. People who are working in education, this idea of proximate learning, that the best learning you do is when it's just barely beyond what you know now, right? But it's graspable. So is there a corollary to that for in the arts, and to theater in particular, and especially around risk-taking? So I want you to think about when you're gathering an audience, or where is your audience? Do you have a set audience that maybe you're trying to move along this line, or you keep putting that proximate, that goal keeps moving further and further ahead? Or are you perhaps finding a new audience each time, and are you thinking about that idea of proximate learning? So we'll go to that, but I want to start with this idea of risk averse, to risk seeking, to way beyond. Where is your audience, where is your community, and where is your art making? yours? Because we won't hear this in LA. It'll be different here. That's what we're trying to learn. Fill it up. And playwrights, definitely jump in. And please do not be embarrassed to say, I will say this. My work is realistic. I'm sorry, it is not pushing really any boundaries whatsoever, right? And that's just the way I write. So there I am. I'm going to put my up. I'm not way on the far right end. I'm more over in the left. So I
but
put
not
that
all the way.
Not all the way. And the content pushes, but not the form, right? So where is your work and where is your audience?
I'll be a playwright too. I try to use a familiar form so I can get away with things in the content.
I love that. That's awesome.
That's
can you give an example of that?
Well, this sounds like it's risky, but it's actually less when you think about it. I wrote a play that's a stand-up comedy routine, and the reason I made sure it was a stand-up comedy routine was so I could get away with talking about things because people could relax because they knew what it was. Does that make sense?
Yeah, mm-hmm. I understand what a stand-up comedy
routine
is. I get
it. I know what my role is when I'm watching a stand-up comedy routine, and that way I get to get away with talking about really anything I please because it's a stand-up comedy routine.
So it's the division of formal on the left side of the spectrum, maybe, but content is more on the
but
right.
But not formal theater necessarily. It
right.
just has to be familiar to the audience.
Right.
I don't have to make it theater familiar. I just have to make it familiar.
Right. Right. They understand that. Yeah. Other people.
And I work for a theater that produced that play, so I think that where we fall, I think when we do push the boundaries on content, we present it in the play where people, okay, that's fairly linear, I can follow that. Mm-hmm. But if we push the form with another of Aditi's plays, people have come to expect a specific type of story, a story that's steeped in a cultural tradition, mm-hmm. any type of cultural tradition, but that they're going to see on stage a story that's not often told. So I think our audience is risk-seeking, but we do couch it in the familiar, either familiar people telling the stories or familiar way of telling the story.
Mm-hmm. I'll share a story.
Yeah.
History theater, we do real stories about real people. And this fall we did a musical about the Lindbergh kidnapping called Baby Case. And it was, it'd be the first show that, first production of it outside of New York. Hadn't been done in 18 years or something like that. I thought it was very safe. It fits our mission perfectly. Lindbergh from Little Falls, the airport's freaking terminals was named after him. He had a notorious lifestyle. All of the stuff that's come out about him, almost every Minnesotan knew something about Charles Lindbergh. And it was a musical about the kidnapping called Baby Case. And, and that was one of the issues, that every time we would say a musical about the kidnapping, our audience, which I thought I knew really well, decided they would not come. They had wanted nothing to do with the musical, and they said that as much to us. So I thought it was like no risk.
Mm-hmm.
It was probably the best production we've done in 5 years, maybe, according to me. how everything went as you planned and better than expected, and virtually nobody came. And mm-hmm. we lost our shirts.
Wow.
So at the box office.
Yeah.
So, you know, risk taking and playing it safe. It reminded me of the Woody Allen line about his love life. He says, women want two things, and I don't know what they are. So you think you know who your audience is, and yet maybe you don't.
What was it about that project that you think was the thing that made them say no?
Well, I was in the airport a week after we opened, and the phones were not ringing, and we didn't make any calls. And a woman grabbed me by the arm and said, I saw the show last night. It was really fabulous. I loved it. It's the best thing I've ever seen. I'm telling all my friends. And the woman next to her said, a musical about a baby kidnapping. I never could see it. And that's the message we heard over and over again.
Mm.
You know, whether it was the title
mm.
or the subject or that it was a musical, mm-hmm. they would not come. And I don't know, maybe it's our marketing or packaging of it. But every time you do a new work, you have to package it in a way that appeals to, well,
our audience base, at least, mm-hmm. and hopefully wider than that. But that was an experience I still live with. It's January, I'm still shaking. Wow, how did that happen?
On the continuum of risk, we live on the other end.
Right.
And when we ask people, when you want to get a ticket, you go online, and then we find you in the coffee shop, and then we take you out to the cars and wherever it is. You know, it's quite a little secret between us, and then people don't often know that there's a performance happening except the people who are there to see it. So when I ask people, we get to know people intimately afterwards. We sit down and we have coffee and ask them how they, maybe it's 9 people, that's our audience. We sell out really quickly. And sometimes it's one at a time. But one of the things that I ask them why they, and I get to know them more personally. Why do you keep coming from this thing to the other? It's because they never know what they'll experience. So for them, theirs is a high risk tolerance. And they don't care really about the content. They care about the experience, and mm-hmm. therefore they want to be really close to what's happening. Mm-hmm. And so we get them really involved by.
So they're almost they're at the end where they feel like they're making it.
They're not making it. We've never had a situation where an audience gets to be in the performance. Although that may change soon. It's more that, we'll use the car as the example, the boundary between performer and observer is not there. So the front seat's the performer, the back seat's the audience. That's the entirety of artifice, everything else is the stage, so to speak. But there's a lot of risk involved, physical, personal risk, being in a car where someone's performing as it's driving. So there's physical risk. We've found out that physical risk is actually interesting to people. They want to take. They feel that there's something in that experience that they want to. And then others wouldn't go near it with a barge pole.
Sure.
Never in a million years will I get in a car where people are stripping down and driving and acting.
They're actually driving.
Yep. Yes. This is not stationary. So that's high risk to say, people like that. There are people who love that. So
I was going to say, our company makes all original work, mm-hmm. often with playwrights mm-hmm. and designers, and often fusing lots of historical ideas together in very physical form. So our audiences are inherently seeking something that's new and maybe risky, but I think also we had an interesting experience where we did one show based on the epic of Gilgamesh, and it sold out. Mm-hmm. It was really beautiful. Like, there was this beautiful singer. Kira wrote it with me. It was like beautiful singers, and it was really beautiful, And then we did Picnic on the Battlefield the next year, which was a mashup of a play by Otterball and one by Mrozek. Who heard of them? No one. Actually, everyone in this room has heard of them, maybe. But, it's like an elite audience that knows who those people are. And it was also a beautiful show, but, we didn't do as well, and we lost our shirts. And I thought, our audience will be excited to come and see something this odd. Mm-hmm. And now we're working on a piece about Brecht and all the women around him, mm-hmm. And that's a musical, so I think actually we're going to do well with that, probably, because it's, again, it's kind of, it's like we're bringing people in for new ideas, but then we're giving them this really, hopefully, they're there also, they want the cookie, too. Our audiences. They
which
want
is,
the cookie is like beauty, actually still. Big bodies moving and gorgeous sound. We're using I use a lot of original sound too. So people come to expect that from us, I think. And so when we do something that's not that, like Pick on the Battlefield was text, I think they were like, I miss the singing and the moving, where is that? Mm-hmm. And the breath piece, again, it's an elite audience in a way. I was thinking about the way that Grotowski speaks about wanting an elite audience. A small amount of people that come and see it, not a big. I think ours is not as elite and small as yours, but probably on the spectrum of the amazing theater we make here, ours is closer to the whatever the side you were doing. It's weird that the right side is
far
that.
Right.
Risk
okay.
Kind of,
yes.
I feel like it should be the left, but okay. It's kind of between Gulgun and I don't know where.
Moo is an Asian American company that does theater and Taiko. So we do it, everything we do is from the Asian American experience, which is a huge umbrella that includes a lot of different cultures. So, and that also, since we're the only Asian, one of the only Asian American companies in town, that also means that our programming takes on a lot of different aesthetics. So we try to, and we also have responsibility to our Asian American community as well as our Asian American artists, and giving them opportunities to do things that they wouldn't regularly be able to do. So we range from new plays by Asian American playwrights to Sondheim, and everything in between. The common denominator is that you will see plays and taiko created by and with Asian Americans. That's the only common thread. So within that, we don't assume that you would like play like Kung Fu Zombies versus Cannibals the same as you would like A Little Night Music. But what we do have in common is that we are telling it through this Asian American aesthetic, whatever that means. And I think we're still trying to figure out what that is. Mm-hmm. But each show is completely different, except for that common denominator.
How long have you guys been producing?
21 years.
Wow, we can go right.
Not me, I have been.
Well, a lot of people have.
So, stability. Does your... Are each of those projects risky in different ways? Do you find yourself knowing that, or do you place each project in a different place?
Each is risky, and we don't have a home.
Right.
So we're also in different venues.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So every project has its own campaign.
Right.
And we have to be clear about what that is. So the person who is expecting us to do A Little Night Music, because that's important to us too, because that gives our artists an opportunity to do a play that they don't usually get a chance to do.
Mm-hmm.
So that they know that we're doing Kung Fu Zombie. We try to do everything we can to make it say, like, this is Kung Fu, this is not A Little Night Music. Mm-hmm. You're not gonna like this if you like A Little Night Music. But maybe your nephew will or something. So, I don't mean to judge, because there's a lot of different people that enjoy it. But to just be very specific about what that is, so they, just because it's Mu doesn't mean that you're gonna get the same kind of play, except for that we're trying to figure out what is the aesthetic, if there is one. What does that mean to go to a Mu show? And the closest thing we've got to is a certain amount of heart, because no one is telling our story except for us, so it means a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
We can't mess this up. And our artists are then committed to the project in a deeper way because no one else is doing it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can I also just ask that, like, as people are, this is great, I think as people are talking about the word risk, I'm a little concerned that the word risk, I actually loathe the word risk. I'm probably talking about it a little, and I also hate that we are, but I think I hate it in the way that people talk about, like, diversity or... liberal, like, I hate it so much, because I feel like risk is like this weird construct that we put onto things that means bad. Like, if you're a producer, it means maybe I won't sell tickets. If it's, or there's like goat fucking on stage, or there's, like, when we say risk, please can we, I would love the theater field to be really specific about when you say risk, what do you mean, and like, where does your fear sit? What is it about? So we're at least talking honestly with each other about, like, risk for you means may not be as beautiful sonically because it's so text heavy. But then you're also, as an artistic director, talking about, as a theater leader, about how many people came,
mm-hmm.
and those are two different risks, rather than that when Miriam and, you know, Steve are talking about, we want to do this play, which is really risky for us. Well, not really, because you're red eyes, so nothing, everything. I mean, you know, that's why I want to go. I want to go to every, you know. I guess I just think it's super important that we be...
It might be about the audience, your particular audience, too. What is risky to one audience is not risky.
Absolutely.
Quite risky to another.
And also risky, to me, it's interesting you have a negative connotation. I think of it as positive. Like, I think all artistic work should be...
Yeah.
But the word has come to mean nothing.
So
it's like become this moniker for, like, we risk.
Okay.
Like, if Kira writes a play, she's risking because she's fucking broke. She's a playwright. She's broke. Or you produce Playron and you risk that, like, you can't have your pay your staff because you might not sell pay. I just want to be, I feel like the marketing part of risk which does have negative connotation, or possibly, it's never, the risk is never, no one's ever like, you know what, I'm producing, bless your heart, I'm going to say this because everyone does it, I'm going to produce, you know, To Kill a Mockingbird, and the risk that you're talking about To Kill a Mockingbird, I mean, maybe people, I don't know, we always, everyone does kind of generally does well with it. I hope you did really well. I mean, no one's ever like, I wonder if I produced To Kill a Mockingbird. The risk is like, not, if we risk it, it's like, if we risk it, and I'm concerned that when we talk about it from a ticket sale perspective, mm-hmm. or an audience engagement perspective, In America, in particular, yeah. we directly connote it with how artists are thinking about taking risks in the way that I think you're talking
about. Yeah, I think, I mean, that's one of our values here at the Playwrights Center, right? Like being able to take risks. And I think that in that sense, you know, being it from an artistic perspective, that I think most artists in their work want to be taking risks, want to push the boundaries of what they are doing and capable of doing. So I think maybe it's coming from two angles, theater perspective, an artist perspective. I don't know any playwright who sits down and is like, yeah, I'm writing a safe play. That's the play I really am excited to write about. It's always, you know, excited to write about. Maybe they're writing it, but excited and have been really are coming from a genuine place about wanting to write that play. It tends to be that they're investigating something or pushing something or challenging themselves emotionally, intellectually, artistically.
Well, risk is so subjective, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, as an audience member, the risk I take is that I'm wasting my time and I'm wasting my money in going to see something that okay. I may or may not like, right? But, I mean, in terms of our context, we all have other jobs. We're not relying on our theater making to earn us a living because we just know it can't. Believe me, we've done all the research now.
Well, let me
take
this for just a second, because I feel like what I was trying to get at here was granular, and what we've done is zoomed up into about orbital. So what I think might be a way to do this and to build on what Jeremy was saying is to have you define how do you think of what does it mean to you?
Absolutely.
And where do you know, is it about trying something new artistically that you don't normally do? Is it a financial risk? Is it a risk that your audience will reject it for some reason? And when you think about risk, and is your audience willing to follow you in things that are unexpected and unusual to them? Is that the, you know? So as I'm asking you to talk about where does your work sit and where does your audience sit in this, we're using the word risk, insert something else, along that continuum, then help define for us what that means for your making and what it means for your audience. So that'll help us get back into the specificity that I'm hoping to get out of this section.
And let me just reiterate, too, that we are also asking playwrights that question, mm-hmm. even if you're not connected to a particular institution.
Absolutely.
Like, just as a writer, that question we do want to know, too.
Right. Like, I love what you said. I write in a kind of, I intentionally write in a form that will be familiar to the audience so that I can insert the content that is going to push them, is what I heard. So, yeah.
I think the risk that we ask of our audience is to be meaning makers.
Okay.
So that the meaning is not handed to them, mm-hmm. that they need to feel, we asked, you know, I was at a workshop recently about logic models, and at the top of the logic model is your vision, right? And our vision at Red Eye is that the world will be full of people who embrace ambiguity. So, you know, if that's how we impact the world over 2 millennia.
So can I ask
you?
Are there things that you come up against then as you're thinking about the plays you want to include that feel like, it would be a risk for us as producers to do it, or a risk as artists to do it, or?
You know, having this discussion, what are the criteria? So Steve selects the work primarily in consultation with me. They have to have a role for me.
Uh-huh.
That's one criteria. After 30 years.
Yeah.
And they we're really, the other criteria we're looking for, as I said, is that they're not going to be done on any other stage. If this is a piece that only Red Eye could do in this community, you know, and I don't mean that somebody else can do them in a different way, but the way that we do the work would not be the same way you would see it anywhere else. That there's some way that we, that our, that the way you're going to move through time and space and story is going to be different at Red Eye and allow you to see something differently. So that's a little vague,
no.
But that's the work that interests us. And I think I agree with Jack about, you know, because we're a founder-led organization, artist-founded-led organization, that it's about Steve and my vision.
Yeah.
And so, unapologetically so.
Great.
And so it's about leading the audience. You know, it's about showing the audience things that they may not know they were missing. You know, it's not something that the audience is asking for, necessarily.
Park Square is planning to expand to two stages after 40 years of one, or using the one. The biggest risk in my mind is that my theory that we can actually develop, serve multiple audiences simultaneously won't work.
Mm.
We are doing that now, and we have been doing it for the last 20 years in one very clear sense. We have that daytime student-teenage audience, which is one, a very discrete audience of teachers and their students, and that's 20-some thousand kids. And then we have that other work that we do, which is built on a traditional subscription model, which takes its shots in a forum like this. but that's built on the risk that we can build trust with that, with a core audience over many, many years. And then the new risk that we're taking on is like, we can do that, and we can do this, and we can do a third thing, which is be strong enough and broad enough to have additional audiences come into the mix that we can legitimately serve over time. And so it's very exciting, but that's full of risk. The model is the risk that I'm most concerned about.
Right.
It's like, I can't pull it off. Or we don't know how to.
Is that audience risk for you, just so I'm hearing you right, that getting new audiences into the second space will be hard, or getting your current audiences in the main stage to the second space?
The model presumes we can do some of both. Because the audience we have with our subscribers, I think, probably fall in Alan's list in that middle, makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
Between risk tolerant and sometimes risk seeking, mm-hmm. not very often risk averse, you know, they wouldn't sign up for a bunch of plays they never heard of.
Right.
They always feel safe because they feel like it's going to be a good piece,
mm-hmm.
and even if they don't like it, they're going to respect it. So that's the trust thing that's built, and so there's quite a range, relative range to content.
Mm-hmm.
But there's some risk factors there. We can't go into the overtly sexual without getting a lot of trouble.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it doesn't mean we won't do it, but we know there's trouble coming.
Right.
Okay. So there's that kind of risk. But again, the larger one is that we talked this morning a lot about the idea of marketing and how we don't like the language, but we need it. And there's a kind of marketing that we do know how to do to that traditional audience, and that we do know how to do to teachers. We don't know how to do the marketing that a lot of you guys do on a regular basis with an audience that just shows up or that finds your particular wonderful eccentric piece.
Mm.
We don't know how to do that yet.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to learn from the rest of you and from our partners, which is why we have partners, to try to pull that off. So it's kind of...
Will you just say really quickly what that is, just so people know that, and just so that I think it's cool for the record what the partners is for that space?
The quick model there is that we developed 5 years ago when we knew we were going to be building out. I invited discussions with at that time it was 22 or 23 homeless theaters in Twin Cities, and I listened to them. And I took notes on what they loved about the spaces that they used and didn't use, and what they hated about them and what they needed. And we decided we didn't want to be a rental house, but we wanted to be in partnership with some groups over a period of time, hopefully to learn from them. So what came out of that was a request for proposals, and what came out of that is three companies that at this point have agreed to be with us for the first three-year cycle. And they'll either do a show every year or a show every other year, depending upon their producing model within the new space. And then we'll be marketing, cross-marketing their shows to our audience and to each of their audiences to each other. And what we're hoping to do is to learn a lot the first year, do better the second year, and walk away the third year further along than we'd ever been without each other. But that's the capsule.
Awesome.
Can I just jump in here to say really, too, so it's in the record that the Southern Theater is starting a similar program with 14 resident companies who will perform in rep over 2 month blocks of time, two or three companies at a time. All the companies make new work.
Wow.
And it will be a subscription model. This is new, like a Netflix. So audiences pay one price a month and they can go see anything they want whenever they want. And this is really exciting and new, and it's, I only know about it because my company is going to be announced very soon. My company is going to be one of the 14.
Mm-hmm.
So I know about it because of that. And it's going to be announced starting next year in 2015.
Yeah.
It's all companies that make original work, so that's kind of its point.
Interesting.
And I don't know, Dayton's not here, so I just wanted to make sure that was out there, that that's going on too.
I think as a writer, it's hard to talk about risk because I think the vocabulary as a writer to talk about it is emotional and personal.
Mm-hmm.
I started to write because the process of writing is how I'm able to make sense of the world. But I was attracted to theater because I had a point of view that I wanted to share with an audience. So I think it's very vexing and very troubling to me that data about writers not having an audience or not thinking about an audience when they're creating a piece.
Mm-hmm.
We were talking over the break a little bit about that audience can be very small and it can become very big, but if you don't have a point of view to share, then why do I need to show up? But also, why make it in the first place? I don't understand that. But I'm also a member of a theater company, Collective, and we have, I kind of feel like what we're doing is always risky because we're programming right now. We're selecting whatever we want to do. It's not like people really pitch the plays that they want to do. It's like, who has something they want to do right now?
Mm-hmm.
And then everyone talks a little bit about what they want to do, and we don't, it's not competitive so far. It hasn't been. We're deciding on Tuesday.
We're not done yet.
Yeah, we're not done yet. So, it's not competitive, and it's pretty generous. And it's like, why does this have to happen for you right now? Like, is this a personal reason you need to get this done right now? Is it a timing thing? Is there a space issue? So, but for that, like, we have a collective of writers who are all so aesthetically different, and we're constantly all changing the form that we write in. So we're always talking to different audiences, and we have a core audience, I think. We have a core audience of people that always come to see a workhouse show, but there's a new audience every time. We could do a better job of marketing. We are playwrights doing all the jobs, but we're always trying to find the community that writer's trying to talk to. So we're really trying to get out of the way, I think, of whatever the writer's trying to say so the writer can talk directly to their audience.
Mm.
So for writers to not be thinking about their audience, I guess they would just never thrive in our theater collective. Because if you can't tell us who you want to talk to, then you can't go find them.
Right?
And,
yeah.
And that's hard for me, so I'll jump off of that. That's hard for me personally. But also, just to add to what Joe said, because I'm also involved with Workhouse, we don't know what the play that we're talking about. So I guess from a institutional point of view, we're all the way in the risk thing, because we actually back the writer. Like the writers who are part of the collective, we don't look at the play at all. The writer could, once they get their shot and it's their slot, and they've talked a little bit about the play, but writers have changed what play they've done. Writers have decided that they want to do a workshop instead of a production. I think Trista's play changed completely to a similar play, which was very odd, but not the same play. So that in that sense, I guess there's a risk institutionally that the writer's not going to, you know, just completely freak out. And that's challenging for us. For me, and I guess maybe because I mentioned this earlier, growing up in a kind of in New York audience, which did seem at the time very varied in race and class, I imagine that audience still exists when it doesn't. So it's very hard for me as a writer to pinpoint like, okay, this is specifically the group I want to talk to, because actually I want to talk to that audience mm-hmm. that I grew up with, which is kind of all everybody. And so that's always been a challenge for me. Creatively, I think risky, I don't know, it's not something I think about. I think it's a little nerdy, actually. It's like thinking that you're cool.
Right.
I don't know that I can sit down and go, I'm going to write a risky play now. Not so risky. I do think along the lines of what Aditi was saying, that sometimes I think that the only way you can surprise an audience is to give them something familiar first, and then kind of keep changing it up. It's an interesting thing sometimes that both spectrums, because I've done a lot of device work and I've done a lot of just writing plays, mm-hmm. and a lot of times both camps can get into a place that is very unsurprising, actually, mm-hmm. in a certain way, mm-hmm. In a similar way. Mm-hmm. So I don't know, artistically the word risk is very big, but I think institutionally you can't talk about risk,
because
you're wondering, is the institution going to survive?
So I want to talk a little bit about the model of a collective, because we're a collective too, and I think there's differences here, because like you guys, we sit down and we talk about who wants to do what, and we have a broad community of artists, some who are emerging and others more sophisticated, and when we've often, for funding reasons, we've chosen to show work in the same building or part of the city, audiences have come thinking that it's all one voice, but it's actually multiple voices. And we've ended up, I may not like what X person ended up doing, because like you, everyone's making their own work, either with playwrights or devising it themselves. There's a huge spectrum of practice. And so the risk we're actually taking is that we're engaging with each other. We're all helping produce each other's work. We're all supporting each other's work. And then if one of the work isn't as good up to our own standards, then we all fall down, you know, in that realm. So the risk is actually both shared and taken on primarily by artists. And we also see our audience as being primarily artists mm-hmm. as well. So it's interesting because, the collective model, I just think, has a different shift than a traditional theatre producing model. And I'm interested that artists are choosing collectives as a way to produce, to get work that they really want done produced, instead of going to more traditional formats to get them done.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to kind of speak to what Joe was saying originally about being about writing for a community or writing for an audience. And so I have a clarifying question though about the spectrum. So
sure.
It's from risk averse to beyond risk seeking.
It's risk averse, risk tolerant, like mm-hmm. All right. Risk-seeking, and then there's the, I actually want to be involved in some way in the creation of the work.
So that's where I feel confused about the spectrum, because I think, as a playwright, my aesthetic choices and the structure and content even is, I guess, non-traditional and non-linear, all those things, but the thing that so if that's risky, then that's risky. But the thing that grounds me, I think, is that part, is that piece of engaging or that piece of communicating with an audience, say, or a context, right? So, and that's important. I think that, so I also then co-operate the Unit Collective, which is a resident company here, and we do the show once a month. And our safest and most successful evenings have been ones that are directly working with like the Seward neighborhood. Mm-hmm. So we like interview like a resident and then put up a play about them, and then tons of people come because they all know that guy, you know?
Right.
So that feels weird that that's on the far end of the spectrum for me, because that's
Well, let me point out and maybe remind those of you who read it, and if you haven't, Alan posits actually that there's a matrix. So this is one part of the matrix, right? This risk averse to, I want to be involved in the creation of the work. And then the other part of the matrix that goes up and down is about engagement. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't know, he's like positing this, and let's test it and see if there's any validity to it. And the bottom of this line is like, no engagement. Come in, sit down, shut up, and go, right? That's that engagement. Up to, you know, other ways of being far more, you know, involved in the post-show discussion, or like, I'm going to
tell you everything I thought about, you know, your work and how you can change it. Those sort of things, or reading it, or being really involved in both pre- and post-show sort of engagement things, and that seems like it there. And so there's actually an up and down along with a right to left.
Sure.
And so I think that that's what you're getting at, is that there's a lot of engagement that's happening up here while you're having this formally, it sounds like, sort of unusual, let's use maybe that word.
Sure.
You know? And those two things are fitting together in that quadrant.
And
does that make sense?
Yeah, and they seem to just go so naturally together. Mm-hmm. You know? So it, that, so in that way, then it feels not risky at all.
But if you're telling the story of someone, and then it makes sense that the neighborhood is going to come
sure.
hear that story.
And yeah, and then maybe it's in a non-traditional format when it's presented that way. But it's so natural that people want to engage in it.
Mm-hmm.
That it just doesn't feel that part. It allows me to take a lot of risks. As a creator, then I have
mm-hmm.
a lot of aesthetic range that I can try and
right.
see if it works, you know.
Right.
But that's the safety. The safety is in the community.
Is the engagement. That's
yeah.
so
right.
awesome.
And I think yeah. So my context then is my safe harbor.
It's your safety net.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Say what you're thinking.
I don't understand this discussion.
Why? What?
Because I think there's a producer hat. Okay, which says. Okay, is this risky, which we brought up? Is this a risk?
Mm-hmm.
But it's a hat I never wear.
Mm-hmm.
I'm an artist. I just do the work
mm-hmm.
that I feel I want to do in front of an audience with the people I'm working with. And then when the work has reached a certain point, and we say, well, now let's go and bring an audience to it. But I don't understand this discussion.
Mm-hmm.
I don't choose to risk less or more.
You just do what you do.
I do what I do. And then I try to find a way to bring people to it because I thought about them when I did it. And I hope that they think about me when they come.
And you're not thinking about, or let me flip that. Are you thinking about specific people you would bring to it? Or like,
no,
no,
oh,
I just think,
no.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah,
I want the whole
thing.
World.
lots of shit ton of them.
Yeah.
But so it's not an issue. I don't. When I go see Matisse, I don't wonder at the time when he painted if it was new to people. Of course, it was new to people because that's what he was painting. So I'm a living artist today, older than most people, but I do what I think I should be doing, and I don't question. That's not the question. The question is how do you get people to see that work? How do we as artists do the work that we do? And then once we've done it, without thinking ever, is this going to sell, is this not going to sell? But is this true to what I'm doing as an artist? And is there an audience in mind? Do I think about it? Of course, I always think about the audience, always. We all do. But it doesn't mean that we take less risks or more. Risk is what we are artists. But I don't understand the measurement.
I would have to agree with Dominique because I haven't said anything all day. And the reason is because of what he said. And it's like every time I sit at the computer, I mean, I've written over 30 plays. Most of them haven't been produced now. Some of them are getting produced, but I still get to the computer and I do the work.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. Like, maybe that's risky, I don't think so. But I'm still gonna be doing it. I've been doing it for 25 years now. So I don't really, I guess I've never seen that as risky. I mean, it's just, I'm an artist, I'm doing the work, and this is the field I've chosen to do it in. And if I don't wanna do that anymore, then I get out of the field.
Right. So let me,
yeah.
Right, I get that totally. And let me just ask a follow-up question, which would be, Are there ever times, or have there been times, in your, that's a lot of work, when you were writing and you were thinking, you know, if I write about this particular issue, or if I write this play in this way, it will have more or less less of a chance of being picked up and produced.
No, I've never thought about that, which is probably why most of them haven't been done. I mean, I'm not being funny. I mean, I'm just being truthful. Absolutely. Because that's never entered the realm of, like, how I think about what projects I do. I'm like, this is what I want to say, and, you know, maybe most people won't be interested in it, and that's fine, but I still have to sit down and write. Mm-hmm. And that's just how I've always approached my work. And
but that
I get commissioned by people now to do projects, mm-hmm. and those are guaranteed to be produced, so
sure.
I'm not going to sit here and say I'm not getting work done, mm-hmm. but those are based on commissioned projects, and also now being able to be part of Workhouse, where I don't have to worry about, is a theater going to produce my work, because I know I'll always have an artistic home to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just been working in the form of always thinking about, well, I don't want to just be powerless and sit around waiting for someone to say yes.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so I guess, like, just listening this afternoon, it was kind of figuring out, well, how do I want to talk about this, because I think Dominique just said it best, that it's, I'm just being an artist.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so I don't operate from this model of, oh, is it going to be risky, or who's going to come, or then I shouldn't be in this field, in my opinion.
Like, I think that's where the 70% number that people have bandied about coming from playwrights.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's really what it means, is that we think of the audience basically as, you know, people. Like, it's not,
yeah.
Like, yeah, you don't, it's very hard to sit down and go, well, okay, I'm going to write for X, because
yeah.
you just, you
know,
because the story interests me, and then you hope, I think as Dominique said, you hope that if you put it out that you're not such a unique, you know, and freakish creature that in the 9 billion people on the planet, there won't be anybody else that doesn't feel the same way, but you're not thinking.
At least the lawyers will show up, though.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Like,
you're
freakish creature.
I think as a playwright, the riskiest part
was,
like, hitting send.
Is what?
Is hitting send and sending it out to anyone.
Because of rejection.
I think that, but also you're asking them to, yeah, I guess rejection.
But just, yeah, projection on many different levels. So it's not just like not getting the
case.
Yeah. It's also something different if you're a producing artist that produces your own work. Like, some of us, our Workhouse does that, where you're made up of artists. My company is too. We don't rely on audience tickets, really, you know, at all anymore.
Yeah.
It's our own, like, whatever we want to do, whatever is our vision right now, that's what gets done. And then, like Dominique said very well, we try to then help an audience who is interested and out there come. But the money is not the driving force. And I'll tell you, my students coming up, I teach at the U, they're all coming to me and saying, we want to make our own work, and I want to also have a day job so I never have to worry about making theater my economic, I want to have a thriving art world and make my money some other way. So money doesn't even enter into it. The theater, Nature Theater of Oklahoma was here, and that was what they were talking about. That's what they do.
Mm-hmm.
They all have day jobs.
Yeah.
So I think the real question we have in common is to say, how can whoever is in the business of funding or helping arts organization, how can they direct audiences to the work these artists are making?
Mm-hmm.
Instead of each of us feeling so isolated and fighting to get a dime every year, a dime,
a dime actual dime,
the funding has become so horrible.
Yes.
And an audience who is no longer, at least in Minnesota, I don't know what it in California, but kids no longer have arts in school, and we see a slowdown of younger audiences because they don't get art education in school. So, and that's a huge issue, huge. So that's what we need for all of us in the room, is how can we get to the money so we can continue doing what we do.
Yes.
I'm interested in what you said about, and you said the same thing about, we make it and then try and help people find it. How do you try and help people find it?
Just talk about it a lot. Honestly, it's not, if you're divorcing the economics and a corporate structure from your theater, if those two things are not in connection, it, like Domi said, it has nothing to do with it. It doesn't enter my mind. You make the art and then you spread the word. You stand like the town crier.
Right.
You get all your friends to spread the word. And now with social media, it's so easy. I was producing in the 80s when you had to still send out paper press releases. You know, this is easy now. And then people come.
If it works good, or they don't. The ones that want to come, and it's like Wartofsky said, I don't want more than 40 people in this audience.
No, I want 1,000 people.
Me too. I want 1,000 people too. I want 1,000
people.
But
the problem is we don't have people coming to our theaters, I think. I think that we need to say that. I think we don't have enough people coming to our theaters.
Yeah.
And that's a huge issue that we have in common.
I thought for a long time that my self-definition for artistic director, at least in the kind of theater that I'm running, is the key job is to bring involved audiences and talented artists into the same room. And so when we talk about audience development marketing, that is my job. And I don't have to use those terms, but finding the and it makes total sense for me that playwrights would sit here and say, and people that create new work are sitting here and saying, I need to do that because then you need people, other people, who will say, we will help you, we will try to help you find what an audience,
right.
Bring an audience to your work. And some of us can, and if we can identify with a certain, with some audience and some artists and bring them together, that's what we try to do over and over and over again.
You know,
but some of you shouldn't be bothered by that.
No.
And some of you, I was thinking about the workhouse group and they're self-producing, that's insane. I mean, it's wonderful, but most playwrights wouldn't have the patience or the will or the multiple layers of creativity to even think of doing.
But it's out of necessity too. So it's it's because this lady over here isn't getting her work produced. So the only place you can see to get her artistic expression
is to do it yourself.
Is to collect, to be a collective. Again,
and directors do that all the time.
Right. And as a director, I have to do that too, as well as all the other people that work in the collective I do. And I just think it's interesting. We're trying to have the same conversation, but we're all working in different models.
Yeah.
The generative artists are saying, I don't want to even think about audience. Collectives are saying, we have to think about audience because we have to think about everything. And then theaters are saying, well, that's my job to think about audience. It's your job to make it. You know, I think in the end, we've got to have people. We all agree that we need people. The question is what our strategies are to go connect to our audience in some way or other. I'm proposing that my strategy is leave the theater, make theater an act, not a space, and leave the theater and get out there and be with people, and you've got automatically an audience. Now, can you make income from that? No.
No.
Here's to tell you.
You know, I'm listening in about who we want in the audiences, and I think a lot of, at least, and maybe it's my own lens, but when I read the report, and there seems to be, at least in the report, a drive for inclusion. And I guess it's, for me, I'm really interested in what a lot of you are saying, is that I want like-minded individuals to be my audience. And I think sometimes, you know, if we can just go out and just say that, hey, I want people who think just like me in my audience, and I'm not really interested in including, you know, the rest of the community in there. Once we narrow down that focus on who you really want in the audience, that it probably would make the thing easier. But when you're trying to get butts in seats, so then you decide that you're going to open up the spread. So, oh, man, you know, we got to reach this ticket goal. So now I got to go out and I got to recruit more people because we want to bring them to theater. Well, if that's not who you really want to receive the work, then I think that's probably where you miss. What I'm trying to say is that I love you all saying that I want 1,000 people to see it. That's really great, but do you want 1,000 like-minded individuals to see the work? Or do you just want 1,000 people?
Really. No.
Well, but I mean, but you do. You do.
No, I really do.
If you wrote that specific piece for
everybody.
But that thinks like you.
No. That responds to you.
Yeah.
I love seeing work from people that I don't understand.
Mm-hmm. I love
going to international festivals where I see shows in multiple languages that I don't understand.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think the rub is that they said that they think about the audience while they're writing the piece. So how far do you think about the audience? Do you think about them when you're writing, but are you thinking about how you're marketing to them?
No, we're saying the opposite. We're thinking. That's why this afternoon I think we got into a weird thing, because from a certain perspective, any kind of segmentation is marketing. From a certain perspective.
from a writer perspective that's just thinking, well, I'm writing this basically, you know, thinking of myself like, you know, Aeschylus. Like, I'm writing it, and, you know, who's going to come
humanity.
See it?
Humanity.
You know? Yeah. you know, and I like you know, Our Town is one of my favorite plays, and, you know, the Mahabharata is one of my favorite plays, and, like, I don't understand people that don't go see everything. I don't, so that's my trouble as a marketer. I don't get it. I don't know how to tell people, come see this, it's going to be just as good
right.
as other desert cities. In fact, it's going to be a lot better than other desert cities. Like, it's not, you don't need to go see, you know, what's the Virginia Woolf? Like 400 different versions of Virginia Woolf. It's another couple drinking and having a fight. You don't need to go see that all the time.
But people who are not couples and don't drink and don't have fights all the time also enjoy that play.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And
right.
I think they'll all also enjoy new work. Yep. Were they to go see it?
Were they
rather than
new
work being
yeah.
niche work? Niche.
That's the philosophy.
Because I think that happens with new work a lot, is we assume it has to be for a specific audience. And honestly, I'm not writing for a specific audience. I'm writing for the world so that I can talk to the world.
And
I don't think
new work is thought of that way, but Hamlet's for everybody. Like, I don't get
yeah.
that either.
And not
yeah.
just Danish people, frankly. Why don't we only see Danish people?
I think the difference is because
Danish people.
At some point in your life, you've had some experience with Hamlet.
Right.
Even if you've never read it, you kind of know what it's about, and you get that. But when there's a new play, it's like, okay, so what do I do with this? And I think we all have to be honest about that's the part where you can either freak it all up or really do a great job with it. And what is this play? How are we talking about it? What's the playwright trying to say? Who did the playwright write this for? And I think what happens is that there's not a large enough conversation about the play itself before people say, okay, yes, Jamil, you wrote this. We're going to produce this. Christina, yeah, market that. You know, it's there needs to be larger conversations about the work and what the playwright's trying to say, who the audience is. And I think that, again, time, money, resources sometimes stop us from doing a lot of that hard work.
If I may, I think this is a perfect transition point because all of the things that you're talking about lead directly into a question I have written down on my little notepad. I would love to hear, with all of these larger, rich topics in mind, specific instances that you have had as artists where you felt like you had an especially connected experience with your audience. Can you think of a moment that you can describe to us now when something happened between you and your audience, whether you as an individual artist or you as a company, that made you feel especially connected to them? And if so, what was it, and why did you feel so connected to them?
So, Captain's Ich Kürbisgeist ends with the audience being handed, they have scrolls that they open up, and there's a monologue for them. They're directed to read it. And the actors sit on stage and listen to this monologue that the audience is reading as a group. And the audience is performing for the actors, and the play ends. And every night, here's the beautiful moment. The first night, we never did it until the audience was there. Right, except for with the choreographer and the director and the stage manager reading, right? So the first night there's an audience, they're reading, and it's continued on a second page, and the beauty of sitting on stage as an actor and hearing them read this and seeing that white flutter of that page all as a group being turned at that same moment, that was when I felt there was this amazing connection between the audience and us. I mean, it was a performance. It was the tables were turned. The audience didn't know that the tables would be turned. But they were, and it turned inside out everyone's expectations of what theater was. The theater was happening in the seats, not on stage.
Did you hear anything from the audiences later who had participated in that event or that moment in the show?
Well, sure.
No, I mean,
yeah.
Of course you did, but I'm just interested, what did they say to you about their experience of that?
Well, ask them.
It was awesome. It was, it's such a, the show is
show such an adventure in something, and I don't totally know how the creative team pulled this off, but as an audience member, I felt like there was some permission given, a challenge given early of just like, you figure it out. You stay, keep up, come on, you're like, let's go. That I was just like, oh, I'm not gonna get this wrong. There's not a quiz at the end. Like, this is for me to devour. And so then it felt like we had been prepared for this moment. And then there's a part in the monologue that has pause as a stage direction. And I'm like, I know this is a stage direction. But and like, but five people in my audience did it, and they were like, pause. But it was fine. Like, there was more in it too. It felt like at the end of this wonderful wild play, like, what else can happen? Like, oh, this is what's going to happen now. This is the right way to sort of release this experience.
And it was about experience.
Yeah.
I don't know how to answer that question, because every show's like that for us, because we're in impossible places together. So we're always connected in some way. There's always a strange environment, and we're asking them to do something, and they're trying to figure it out. And there's always a conversation at the end. So it's like with everything.
I
don't know how to choose one,
because
it's everything.
I would agree. I think I don't know how to answer the question. I don't know how you can qualify it. That's our job. My job as an actor every night is to connect with the audience and hope that they connect back. Whether we're creating new work or we're doing Hamlet or whatever it is. So it's the same as the question of risk. We don't feel like we're taking a risk because we know our point of view. I always feel like I'm connecting with the audience, and it sucks when there's one night when you're like, fuck, they're just not with me. Mm-hmm. But that's why we do it. To search on moment by moment, night by night, for that connection. And the beauty of it is that connection is theirs. They can go as far this way into it as they want, or they can come to you and go, I'm not into it. But your job is to defend what you're doing so they are connected in some way, and then it's their choice to go in or not.
We rarely have issues with an audience not connecting. I mean, some people come, they don't like it, that's fine, that's good. But mostly our job is to make sure that people who enter the room are invited into an event that we create for them. And it's ours to share. That's not our problem. The problem is not having enough people to come and see it, to see the water. That's, I think, what we have in common as a problem.
You have a lot of performers in the circle right now, and I think performers, that actually is what we do.
Yeah.
It's a
different question, you're right.
Yeah.
For an actor.
And for writers, I'm in such a state of frozen terror when the show is going on. I couldn't tell you what was happening.
You've never overcome
You know, occasionally, this goes back to what Aditi and I were saying, we were saying a little differently. Occasionally, if it's a real genre play, and there's some kind of thriller element, and they're actually getting to the point of like, no, don't look at the necklace, don't look. Like, I can hear people muttering, and don't bring that up, it's going to get you. Like, that's just fun, because they're having a good time.
This reminds me of a moment I saw The Jean Moon Hamlet years ago, and I was watching it, and I was enjoying the show, but on a very intellectual, like, oh, wow, that's how they handled that, that's really interesting kind of way. And towards the end, I hear this one, maybe I wrote 5, 60, 70-year-old ladies behind me, and they started to go crazy, like, no, she's going to drink it, that's poison! And I realized, they don't know how this ends. I'm not sure how they got to there, they don't know how this ends. And it just turned the play around, and we were like, and so I was half watching them and half with my ears glued to these ladies who were going crazy. It's like, oh, but ladies, you are so fucked. This is going to go so badly for you. And they were just devastated at the end. They didn't think it was going to be a tragedy. And it turned the play around for me. It's one of the best experiences in the theater. I had been enjoying the play on a different level, and it just turned it back into the visceral thing it should have been.
And with a new play, it can be like that every time.
I'm like, well, this is new to you.
I feel like it's really interesting to talk about the live experience and what that is and what it has become in theater with the proscenium and the wall And I think that we have nurtured passive audience members.
Yes, we have. Mm-hmm.
That now we're trying to do things to engage them outside of just having a dynamic performance that is actually communicating. And so I think there's a bigger question of like, how are we creating, how are we performing theater? And beyond like, okay, there might be a dance party or food, or beyond that, is just the performance itself, and does it have that engagement? And how do we, without saying, okay, we're going to throw something at you. They're active, I see it. I will watch my audiences, and they come in, and they're like, okay, what do you have for me? Rather than like, I can't wait to see that. And then I feel also I've been in performances where it wouldn't matter if I was in the audience or not. It was going to go on without me, and I could walk around, I could start turning lights off, and they would still just keep going the way that there's it doesn't feel live. And I think that's that there needs to be, I always, in a rock concert, any kind of live music, there's always that feeling of that this is happening right now and only for me. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's sometimes why people aren't going to the theater, because we're still doing some theaters, some performances are with that, we're over here, it's TV, why don't I just sit at home and watch this?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Because I can at least have a drink and be in my pajamas and
I wonder if that's cultural too, because I know when that my play Four Little Girls was done at Stepping Stone, every time I would go to the show, there was always a call and response between the audience and the performers, that they were just constantly interacting with the kids on stage. And it was never a quiet experience.
I want to call out the Children's Theater a little bit. Good, because you have them when they're not jaded.
Mm-hmm. And that's what as you're talking, it feels like that's a real learned experience. Mm-hmm. Like we're at the theater now, so we're going to sit and be quiet in this dark room, because that's not how any of our shows are. I mean, especially a room full of kids. I mean, it's interesting because when we have our school shows, which is mostly kids and a couple of teachers, you know, for a group of 20 kids or whatever, those shows are so alive and so exciting. And when they come in the evening shows, when it's parents and, you know, it's more of a ratio of adults to kids, it's a much quieter room. But they're encouraged to, I mean, you know, we just did a panto for a holiday show, mm-hmm. and so that was great with a group of kids because they are interacting constantly. And so I really do think it's a learned behavior. And it's almost like we work so hard then as adults to get people to say, oh no, we can break the wall here. You can participate. And if you don't know you can do that, we're all sitting in a room and just afraid, I think, to get involved. You have to be given permission. When you're younger, you just are engaged and talk back and answer the questions and don't stay quiet because you're not supposed to talk to the actors, you know?
And that's what I was trying to, thank you for saying that. And that's just going back to the point. That's what I'm trying to say. Do you want people who are going to yell back at you while you're performing, or do you want people to sit back and have this type of experience in your audience? And that's just what I'm saying. Like, who is it that you want in the arts? Do you want traditional theater goers who are going to sit there, wait for you to perform, lean in, be there, breathe with you? Or do you want somebody when when you open that door in the horror movie, so, bitch, don't do that. You know, is that who you want? Is that who you want in your audience?
If you
if you do, then there are ways to go find them. You just tell them, hey, you can do that. You know, I talked about it earlier. It's how you open up the door for them in the experience. You know, and sometimes it's something as simple as, don't tell people to turn off their cell phones when they get into the theater, right? Because if you tell someone, hey, you know, don't take pictures, turn off your cell phones, make sure it's muted, that's, I know what type of theater experience I'm going to have. You tell me, don't have my cell phone on, but I want you to engage and interact. For some people, like, having their cell phone on, it allows them to be more present in a way, and I know that sounds stupid, but like for some people that's okay. Or if you say, hey, you can bring your food into the theater, well then again, maybe now I'm going to have a different experience. So going back to who is it that you really want in your audience? And then what are you doing to make sure that they feel comfortable in your space? Not only are you telling them that I'm doing this thing, but once you get here, how you interact with me, I'm going to let you decide how you're going to interact with me. I'm going to do my thing up here, and you can tell me how you want to interact. That I think, is that's the disconnect I feel sometimes when I go into theater, is that I feel like this experience is saying that you want me to experience this in a specific way, but there's been nothing done on this side of the proscenium to encourage me to do that. And so that's why I feel like sometimes we're not getting those audiences that we want.
What about 10,000 things? Kira, can you talk about your... I would be curious to hear you talk about this from the perspective of the work that you guys do.
Well, 10,000 things is such a different model, but this notion of barriers, they're all removed. Right. Yeah. So the audience is... You know, the play's happening here. And the audience is also part of it all the time because the lights are on. So that as you watch the play, you're also watching the audience watch the play. And I think that's a subtle thing, but a really profound thing, because it creates a kind of instant sense of community.
I'm also thinking about, though, when you go into prisons and such, mm-hmm. I mean, we talk about children's theater as an audience that isn't necessarily know the rules and etiquette.
Right.
And I know it's really, I've gone to see 10,000 things shows at Dorothy Day and other places, mm-hmm. and I find the audience that they're so engaged.
Well, they're very engaged, and I think the difference is that they're meeting the story. You know, there's traditional theater going audiences and non-traditional theater going audiences. Mm-hmm. And in the non-traditional audiences, they're meeting the play for its story, and they're experiencing it through the lens of their own lived experience, which is very different than a traditional theater going audience, which is most who've all been to the theater and who, like you, is judging it against all the Hamlets they've seen before. Here, the story becomes essential in 10,000 things. So it's actually quite profound.
Yes.
You begin to see how the story shifts through the lens. So a story, for example, in a women's prison is going to be very different than in, a juvenile delinquency or a homeless shelter or a...
And Nathan and I have performed with 10,000.
So they can really speak to that, but it's an incredible...
There's a dynamic difference between being in a women's prison and doing El Campiello and doing even the open book, the public performances where it's theater people. And sometimes we crave that naughty, or not just like,
they're
more
hungry.
Like children. In
they're
that
hungry.
They just react. We're like, they're about to kiss. Ooh, kiss them. Or whatever it is, and like, the laughter is real. The laughter is like, it's like, it's not like, oh, that was an amusing bit. It's like, holy shit, they just did that, you know? And there's a difference.
It's immediate. It's really, once you've worked for an audience like that, it does feel very, very hard to be in a different
dynamic. And in contrast, our audiences tend to be more art savvy, theater. People go to see performance and want like a bigger hit, whatever you want to call that. When we have to give them permission. We say, please use your cell phones and turn them on and track, because that we want that. We want them to be talking to everybody all the way throughout as they're walking through whatever it is. And we ask them to, shout whatever you want to say, go ahead. And it's just going to take longer, but go, you know. So we actually have to undo what the permit, because people often come saying, being, passive, and we want them active. So we have to teach them how to activate.
But, I was at the Guthrie, just saw Tristan and Amy Assault, and when you're in an experience like that, I mean, that is a company that is actively asking, they're literally looking at the audience. Mm-hmm. They're asking the audience again and again and again to stay with me. Mm-hmm. So that's exactly right. I think but you have to work harder. I think with the traditional audience to make them feel
because
if they're part of
and it is regional and it is class
and it's all class.
And we can tell them walk in, go in, go. You can look around. You can turn things upside down.
So it's about the rules of engagement.
I also think it's a little bit the responsibility of the play and or the production to set up what it's going to be in the first. I swear to Like, I feel like if you're going to smoke a lot and swear a lot and be kind of naked, do it in the first 2 minutes. People know what they're in for, they're on board, and then you do your other things that you're going to do, too. But there's no reason not to do it in the first... Literally, if they're smoking in a show in Minnesota, because they might walk out.
That's true.
We should always light up in the first 2 minutes. That way, if you're going to walk out, you walk out now, and... the rest of you, we're good. We're good. We can hang now, you know? Mm-hmm. I do think it's a responsibility of the play also,
to show you what it's going to be. Yeah.
So
this is how to watch.
I have a question for those of you who think about, are there things the producer, however big or small, can do to help jumpstart, you know, rather than lock everybody up in a room to see the play, what are the things that the producer can do to jumpstart that engagement so that the audience is ready to be like the kid who just goes, yeah, or the, right? What are the things have you ever had an experience where someone has helped do the stuff or you've helped generate stuff?
Letting drinks and food into the room for the Displaced Hindu Gods trilogy, we had the loosest audience. They were so, I mean, okay, alcohol, yeah. But not all of them were drinking alcohol, but they had a drink.
You guys had food, too. They had a food truck.
We had samosas and margaritas, which I realized that's not Indian, but whatever. but, I mean, it made, like, and everyone was just sort of relaxed. And, I mean, I grant you, the plays also tell you to relax a lot. But
the plays or the place?
The plays.
The plays.
And the place.
And the place. I mean, they turned into a cabaret-style thing because of the stand-up. But something about, like, when I was being an audience member there, something about the fact that I had some food and I had something to drink was very relaxing.
In the space.
In the space. Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, make the theater free.
And we have a poster wall. When you come in, we have a poster wall that says, tell us what you think. Like, we are actively trying to hear from you, you know? Mm-hmm. There's a television monitor with people talking on it and say, talk! You know, we used to have a sign that said concessions are allowed in the theater, and we used to joke about it, but it becomes a mantra. Like, whatever concession you want to make while you're in this theater, make it. Yes, I mean, obviously it does mean you can take your food in there, but we are willing to make certain concessions. You know, Jack for 40, 30 something years has never, hates curtain speeches, right? Because he wants people just to get into the action of the play and just be there. So I feel like those are those types of things, you know? Like, just set your space, you know, and tell people.
I think it's important that we don't wait until people get to the place, to see the plays, to say it's okay to be crazy.
Yeah.
Because if I know that in advance that I could just be my crazy self, then I will wear my crazy jeans, and I will feel more comfortable in this environment and you know, act in that way. But I think it's important that audience members know before they get there kind of what to expect, but kind of not what to expect, and to be able to feel a certain amount of freedom. I remember when I first got to grad school and started seeing a tremendous amount of Broadway plays, I always felt this, I was like, oh my goodness, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to dress? What am I supposed to wear? And then after a while, it's just like, you know what, screw it. I'm going, got on these jeans, I'm going to, you know. But people need to know that they can be comfortable. And it doesn't matter who's on stage. I'm a very vocal, loud theater goer. And sometimes my friends sometimes my friend hates to see theater with me, but I am. But I think, I know that, as a former actor, I know that actors enjoy hearing from the audience, and sometimes I just can't be quiet about what I'm seeing. So I think it's important to let people know that, yes, you can come into this place, you can dress how you want to dress, you can be yourself, you can be as loud as you want to be, and let's have a good time.
And how do you do that?
How do you do that?
Mm-hmm.
You tell them. You tell people. You say, you know, you can tell them what the subject matter is about. But I think what...
No, but that thing. I mean, as you say, before you get there, I mean... Just wondering.
Yeah.
You send them an email, or you tell them on social
media.
Explicitly,
have you played around with explicitly saying, and you can wear jeans?
Not so much. I might after today.
But we did dress like a zombie. We did. And we gave them a discount along with that. If you wear that, you get.
But
we actually gave people $5.
But isn't part of it also like the place that you're. I keep hearing talk about the room we enter or the space we enter. If I'm entering a car where Goulden's half naked and giving me, you know, fish tacos, I'm going to feel like I can relax. That feels good to me.
You will.
but that's also about trusting a company and trusting a brand.
But what I'm saying is, when I go to see cabaret at the whatever that thing is downtown, my experience of it is like, ooh, I'm sitting up so high. I paid so much X amount of dollars to go see it, or I go to any place anywhere. where the seats are red and the is and the and I'm looking next to and everyone's kind of white and everyone's kind of got a SUV. I mean, this is where class and place, where our art is taking place,
matters.
So I think part of the conversation, because I think your question is right, how do you how do you just communicate that? Part of it is, I don't worry about how you communicate it. I definitely don't worry about how you communicate it. I definitely don't worry about how you communicate it, because even if I've never been to a moving company show before, I walk into whatever space you're in. You're choosing spaces really consciously. You're choosing spaces really consciously where your work is happening. I go see your shows at Mixed Blood or at the Southern. You are telling me, I am being told how to engage with the art in that way. I do think, and I am not going to pull this down to the road that I pulled this off of this morning, but I just think that part of the challenge that we say about having 2,200 seats or 1,500 seats to sell a night is...
Or 500
seats a night. God knows. 199 seats.
Proscenium.
There is a... When we are... I'm taking us out. I'm going to move out of the Twin Cities. When new buildings are being built, a tiny company has a new space. You're not saying, I'm building a new theater that prevents people from coming in. You're saying, I'm choosing a space at the Southern that will include the people I want. Richard, when you're talking about your second space, you're not saying, I'm going to make sure that there's red curtains that have a tassel on them, because you're actually inviting people in a different kind of way. And you're really, you've brought playwrights, you've brought artists into that conversation, you're bringing resident companies. I mean, it couldn't be more thoughtful in terms of how you're getting there, about how you invite people in. So I think there's actually something to say.
I mean, I wasn't trying to put... seen it on the spot, but we have history, and so, I mean, is some of it, do you use images? I mean, it's like, what are the pictures we use of what the people look like? Because people do learn over time. You can go to Broadway in jeans because you go once and it's okay, and you're going to go again, and so what are those images that we, as we think about developing audiences, what are the images that, all of that stuff, I guess, has resonance, so that you get people in there ready to.
And I think what's a thing that's different for our subscribers is that, like Moo, we're nomadic. So even though we're at the Pantages for Cabaret, which is a venue that suits that show really well, we're at the Lab Theater for Our Town,
right.
which is different. So they follow us from place to place, and they know what to expect from us. The challenge for us is to make sure that all of these new people that we encounter along the way, we wrap them into the fold and say, okay, this is how we do business, and this is what our expectations of however high or low they are, and here's all you need to do to actively participate in that. One of the things, I'm very new to La Teda, I've been there only 2 months now, but for me, the biggest thing is customer service. How are we talking to people? How much are we saying thank you for the things that they're doing for us? Because like everybody, we have so many things that we could be doing with our time. So I'm actively communicating with people all the time, saying thank you for doing this and thank you for everything. But I think it's just talking to people about what's okay and showing them what's okay. Once they see it, then they know, and then they act accordingly. I hate to use the word act. I hate to say act accordingly, but they understand what's accepted.
Expected.
From a traditional point of view, though, I think I'm really challenged by the whole movement for that participation piece of the spectrum. And when I see the stats, or I see the studies, or I just experience our culture, I believe there's a lot of truth to that. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how to crack it or how to serve it. Mm-hmm. And I think that we all, I don't want to jettison being who we are or who we perform for. I want to add to is my ambition. And I guess that's just But I think in order to add to, there has to be this other dimension of what happens before and after has to be more thoughtful too, which is part of what you're trying to get to.
Right.
And I think we can prepare our audience, but I also think that a But I can't do what you mentioned, Trudier, this morning, where he, as the artistic director, stays and facilitates every post-show discussion. I ain't going to do that. I'd love to in theory, but I'm not.
And he was very honest in this instance that he needed to learn who his audience was because he was new to town.
Yeah.
And that was, and I suspect over time it will not
but
be
there,
him.
But there is a theory.
It's not
theory
him anymore,
that.
But there's a commitment to doing that discussion.
There's a theory that Steppenwolf was apparently testing where they try to set it up so that the audience talks to each other rather than through the artist or through the facilitator. That fascinates me. James Williams told me about Signature Theater in New York where they'll just set up a circle of chairs in the lobby, and if audience people want to stay and talk to each other and make their own circle, they do that.
The Walker does that.
There are, pardon?
The Walker does it.
Okay, so I just think some of these are techniques, but I think the spirit is really real right now, and we're looking for ways to.
Also, people are getting smaller instead of bigger. I think that's exciting. I have I know a lot of artists now making work in their living rooms. We're very curated
space. Yeah, I just can't pay my staff on that. So
it's a totally different model.
I think it's cool.
There was a time when everyone wanted to get bigger and bigger and bigger and build bigger and bigger places.
I feel like
people are craving community, they're craving connection, and it results in, I'm going to do a series of small dances in living rooms around the
I think that's really
bars.
Valid. I agree. Yeah. I think connecting, which we're all talking about, is the hard part. And the bigger you are, the harder it is to make that.
And then money
real.
Becomes your bottom line when you're bigger too, so that gets
money
harder.
Money is bottom line. I mean, just that's what it means.
Right.
Yeah.
But I wanted to come back to that audience engagement topic. You asked a long time ago about what are the questions we would ask, want to know from audiences. And one thing is, because of the finding that people who had the chance to have a conversation with friends, or what about all of the people who come to theater alone? So your boyfriend, posit, maybe not just because you were the one who was making the effort to get him to the theater, but also because if he has to go alone and doesn't have somebody to talk about it afterwards, where's the meaning in that? So how do we provide, and I think it's valid to go see theater by yourself. I mean, I don't think it has to necessarily be a group activity, but then how do we allow for community to form around that activity? So, you know, these ideas about a circle of chairs, I mean, that's all interesting. So, maybe one question is, you know, how would you like to talk about the piece afterwards? Do you want to do it in a, you know, with various options in a facilitated conversation, or would you like to have, you know, whatever?
How important is it to talk about it, to think about it,
right,
to write all of those different things?
Right. One of the things that I've found exciting here is that artists have started writing responses to works they're seeing as opposed to critics. And so Dominic Orlando, Rachel Yamjayevsky, and Charles Campbell, a number of folks in the community have been using either The Walker or other places to publish this work that I think really, that's the work that I find really interesting to read and allows me to think about my own experience of the work and their experience and to have a balance internally about that work. So that's, and I don't know if the general public is aware of those, you know, is it an inside, but so much more interesting than criticism.
Well, no. Building upon what you were saying just a moment ago, I think, you know, people are trying different things, and they're, you know, from the formal sort of talk back to talk amongst yourselves to circles in the lobby. I know that I think the South Coast Rep occasionally puts questions on various columns in the lobby, and if you're interested in talking about that question after the show, you go and congregate there. I was in a show not too many years ago at the Magic, and pretty regularly, once or twice a week, they would, you know, tell us, we're going to give you drinks after the show if you just go out and stand there for 15 minutes and talk to people. That was a really great way to get any actor to come out and hang out and talk to the audience, which was another way of doing it. But I've almost always, when I go to the theater and one of those things is happening, I have no idea it was happening until I got to the theater and they announced it. And what way, right? And so I'm like, well, I wished I'd know, but now I have to run out of here and get dinner, or I'm planning to, you know. Why don't we use that as a way of can we use it a way of reaching out to a kind of audience that wants to respond maybe in that way? So where was it? Your boyfriend, who maybe would be more enticed to go if he knew he was going to be
boyfriend.
Able to have drinks with the, you know, or maybe, or I know they do this in Chicago. They say, the whole cast is going out to this bar across the street. Join us, right? Like, if it's that night, maybe you would go to that one. I mean, and but we need to tell them before you walk in that evening, because
for the last 35 years, we stood in the lobby after the show.
Yeah, you guys.
We greet the audience.
But, you know, it's very hard.
So I think every one of us has a different way to do it.
We've talked about class differences, but I think that I believe there's also a generational difference as to how we use and process theater.
Mm-hmm.
And it may not be right, but one of our takeaways from the intrinsic impact work that we were participating in, tell me if it's a real takeaway or it's legitimate, but we felt we learned that the audience that I'm coming from, the boomer-esque audience, we tend to really prepare for our artistic experience. We build toward the cultural event.
Mm-hmm.
The younger audience tends to start with the cultural event and they go from there.
Right.
And that it's a big difference then as to how that experience is used and both how it's entered and what people need out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think part of the challenge of us, some of us that want to serve the spectrum, is well, how do we serve both? You know, those different styles.
Right.
We learned from our younger audiences that they didn't want to do that. They didn't want to learn too much about everything.
No, they didn't want to prep at
all. And they also didn't want to stay in the room and talk to us.
No.
They wanted to go somewhere with their friends and talk about us.
Among themselves.
And so we facilitate that.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We facilitate that with our work. We invite other people to host a conversation, and we do it for other people because we are genuinely curious. And the Walker does this. They make it well known. They have a bar at the back of the stage.
Yeah.
And I still don't even like being in the theater, personally.
Mm.
I would just want to go somewhere else, relax, not even think about the space, and just get into it. Because, you know, that's where we really want to have that conversation about what we just saw. Without the confines.
Another question I have about audiences is there seemed, it was dancing around in almost. But this assumption that it's young audiences that are going to be open to new work, when our experience is that it's older audiences that are much more open to new work that is experimental in particular. I think because of their vast experience and that they're at a point where they're not deciding what theater is about, but are open to, they're just more open.
Younger people in general,
and that's always, you know. So we've got to make assumptions about
the
audience
loaded,
for new
layered.
Work is. It always seems like it's. I mean, I'm very interested. Of course, I am in the young audiences. And don't get me wrong, but to say it's about how, you know, it's also about really serving that older audience as being adventurous.
I
mean,
they're
not.
Right.
Your conservative.
I wish Bedlam was here.
Yes,
no one from Bedlam is here.
I think what's happened with the young audiences thing, because that struck me, is that it's not that young audiences. I think young audiences are attracted to new work, but I think that they have been. A lot of my friends that don't make theater don't go to the theater because what's happening on stage doesn't care about them.
Mm-hmm.
That's how they feel.
Yeah.
They're like, this is irrelevant to me because I'm not going to go. So, and I think that's it. That it's not that they're not adventurous, it's that what's finding, what they're somehow going to, or what's finding its way up on the stage in front of them isn't relevant to them, or they feel it's not relevant to them.
That's why I wish Bedlam was here. They do that so well. Bedlam Theater is just a theater you guys should know about. They bring in, like, they pack in young people, and they do it by making stuff.
Well, we also, I think people who do, I mean, that's one of the arts and education work, what you're really doing is you're trying to help teenagers find access points that make it, them understand it has to do with them. And one of the things, I was thinking about when you talk about it, is that if you tell them too much about the play and they don't know, but then you ruin that moment, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's one of the wonderful things about meeting plays that are in the canon is that you don't know so much that you actually understand what's going to happen. Anyway, there was someone over there.
Yeah, I was going to say, you know, specific to us here, one of the challenges, you know, around getting audiences just in general, but audiences to new work, I mean, that it's effing cold and snow for 7 months, you know, like, so, you know, so that's another hurdle that we have to get over. And, and you know, I think some of the exciting work too, though, and, you know, I had the opportunity to work on a play that Randy directed for us here at Mixed Blood, is that we've been taking our show into schools, right? So as opposed to saying, hey, young people, we have this great anti-bullying and gun violence, all shoot me in the head. I didn't mean, I take it all back, if I could just hit rewind, take the last 10 seconds, well, we have this play about anti-bullying and gun violence, and oh my gosh, I wouldn't want to go see that, as a student, you know, I wouldn't want to go and travel to a theater, but when we go, when we drop it right there in their school, right, and they're pissed off all the way until they get into the room, you know, they're chatting with their friends, oh my gosh, the show's going to suck, you know, and then they sit and they see it, and they have a great experience. And then, you know, it's been facilitated by some government officials from Hennepin County, and they tell you everything about the play. Like, I've been sitting in the room, and the connections that they make, you know, maybe this is my own fault, but they're making more connections than I am, right? And I've been sitting in the room. So it's about, well, that's the other challenge. And this is a new play, right? So what if we take it to them, right? We're always saying, like, hey, we can't get audiences to come to our play. Why don't we just go to them? And we say, hey, where are you guys? You're in your community center? Okay, we just built this set that can travel. We'll just pop it right down. We'll pop it right down and do it. So, I mean, that's part of the model move and Latte Da and a lot of, and I've never seen a show that you guys do, but I hear now that you guys are selective about your space. So, really, that's another thing that we can't always ask people to come to our buildings with bad parking downtown in shoddy sections of, you know, shoddy sections of the city, you know? Yeah, so maybe we just need to do a better job of making mobile theater and getting it out to them, especially when the weather's bad.
And I want to come back to that spectrum question that you had, because I thought that that furthest thing on risk is about having the audience create the, which there's been a lot of conversation about, like, through social media, where the audience is actually in the involved in the creation of the work, so that it has to do not with like crowdsourcing, and that they're controlling how that experience ends, like a multiple. I don't even know the video.
Yeah, just as a little bit of context, I think where that really came from, as we were having conversations with Alan and getting him, preparing him to do that research. We were asking a question that I think he was trying to answer in that piece, which was, who are these people who want to come to a reading of a play or a workshop, rather, I mean, just spend, even if it's brief, why would they want to spend their 2 hours doing that instead of seeing a full production with sets and costumes and people who memorize their lines? Like, why do they choose to do that, right? And the idea that he's working from is that there's some added satisfaction, that it's a slim number, but that some certain slim number of our audience really gets from knowing that that interchange that they have with the playwright afterwards is actually going to, in some way, affect the how that play will wind up actually looking like. Mm-hmm. So there's some people really do enjoy that, and he's positing that beyond sort of risk-seeking is this thing of, like, I was actually in the room before it was fully baked, mm-hmm. and my response had something to do with how that cake, you know, looked and tasted like 6 months later.
There are some companies, like Nautilus Music did, that does that very intentionally. Mm-hmm. They have, they have workshops constantly, and their workshops are always packed, and people do follow the pieces until full production, if they do go to full production.
And it may also speak to the issue of, I just thought of this, of why that traditional older audience is better with risk, because they may have the time on their hands, right? Some of them may have the time to actually take advantage of those things when theaters offer them, whereas the... And they have the income, they have the discretionary income, or they can take the, right, if you have to take time off from work to go do that, you can't do that, right? And so, and that's what, I mean, one of the other things that Alan found is that propensity for enjoying work of all types increases if you read plays, right? I mean, the more you're kind of versed in the thing, mm-hmm. the more you're able to absorb different parts of it.
So that was part of what he meant, but I think that participatory thing is also a phase. Yeah, anyway. Whoops, there was a voice.
Oh, I was just going to say, I think also just older people, just about the timeline of history, what was happening when people are coming of age in the 60s and other things. It was a different time period where it was more liberal thinking than people coming of age in the 80s and, you know, in the 90s even. And so I think that there's something historically about that generation. And then even what Kelly was saying about aesthetically, people who were exposed to work that was happening at that period of time, it was more experimental work than what is happening in the theater currently. I think about my mother, and I think about people of that generation, of her generation, and they're very adventurous theater goers.
I also think it depends on who we're talking about as our audience. I mean, we've talked a lot about artists coming to our own work, and you know, I mean, that's great, and we all love to participate in everything, but if we're talking about audience engagement, are we talking about people who aren't in the theater, too? I mean, that's, you know, thinking about, like, how we engage our board members. They love to come to things that are, like, readings of shows that we're working on because it's a whole different world for them. Mm-hmm. You know, the theater making is sexy and interesting and different. So that's a way to engage audiences that are not, you know, of our type.
I'm curious about, because, you know, building audiences, and to me, I would love to talk about how a media covers theater, or how we spread the word of theater. Because I think that's the idea of criticism or how it's written in the paper, which is still the way that people look for. We still don't have a comprehensive place to go with all the theaters happening today, where I can go to, and you know, to me, it's like. Those are all, if there was a stronger foundation and structure that would enable people, just information about what is going on. And theaters are also, we are very protective of the data, you know, our emails and our audiences and, you know, sharing that. But more importantly, I think you brought up other artists writing about, Marion, writing about art, and how do we make that the more popular way of rather than and looking at and
it's
what
happening.
Do what do
it's
papers
already happening.
People are still looking at the paper though, and those are the same theaters I see a lot of the times are being previewed and reviewed, and the writing quality of it and the comprehension of it, and where are we reaching? Say, we want to reach young people, or what are their where they're looking at on the internet? Are we there? Are we present at the baseball games? Are we present? And I think there's a bigger issue that it keeps becoming feeling like this elitist thing because the coverage of it is of that. I don't know. I don't get to hear a lot of things that and I'm a theater person. So to me, there is that idea of how do we get more people to see, to know about things, than to see, to come out of their houses and come and see things.
One of the things at the city that I find, a lot of people talk to me about this issue, not just in theater, but in all art forms, that there isn't a comprehensive way in which anyone, whether they're outside or inside the Twin Cities region, can go to one place to go to online to get the download of what's happening on any particular day.
New Yorker.
And that's actually a challenge that I've been trying to work towards, and it's very difficult because it's about curating what's in there to some degree. I mean, other cities have things like Time Out, which also provides criticism, but we don't have the density in this region of art delivery that say, New York or in LA does. So it's actually a business model that's really challenging. So there's a structural issue there. And then, of course, in terms of the critics themselves, you know that they're covering every single art form, not just theater. So they don't necessarily even have a theater background if they're covering it. And
but we do.
Problem.
We have, you know, the Minnesota Theater Alliance has on their website a comprehensive list of all the things that are happening in the cities. I mean, you know, Minnesota Playlist has what's showing. You know, I mean, and also Minnesota Theater Alliance also has this audience exchange program. I mean, these things are there. Of course, they're, you know, it's a membership, so you have to buy into it and things like that. And the publicity around it is low. You know, I sit here as a board member saying that we got to do a better job of it. But there are these things in place. I think, you know, hey, it's Minnesota, we're all busy theater makers, so we are buried in our own work. So sometimes it's hard to put our heads out of our turtle shell sometimes. But there is a lot of stuff that's happening. I think we all do. It's great that we get an opportunity to spend 6 hours together here. You know, and I wish a representative of the Minnesota Theater Alliance, outside of myself, was, and Randy now, could speak to some of these things. But there are there. I just think we have to seek it out.
But I think Randy, city, you're talking about an audience. City. You're talking about from the audience.
From the audience, sure.
St. Paul, yeah. Minnesota, the city, yes. the tourism,
sure,
whatever
yes.
that is, needs yeah. to put money
yes.
in.
Yes, you're right.
Not
you're,
me run the thing.
Yeah,
I'm running a theater. Like,
yeah, yeah,
I don't
you're absolutely right.
Thing.
You're absolutely right.
So full-time.
You're absolutely right.
And you're right.
You're right.
Sorry. I actually want to talk to you about that's totally related to that. That's happening. But you also, I think, said something really important, which is that people have to be willing. You also have to move. Everywhere there are collective databases, it's because people have taken a leap that says, my customer is your, right? That in fact, it isn't my audience, right? It's a bunch of people.
Yes.
And so one of the things is that you just start, you stop thinking about, you
get
you're right. Someone else has to do that, the calendaring work, but the,
right.
but the thing that says we're going to, understand that we are all actually talking to some of the same people, or could be, comes from within, right?
Yeah. Well, Tori and I are both running shared databases. These exist in cities around the country. Well, you're establishing one in the Bay Area. We've run it for 5 years. We've got 1.8 million people in it, and they are, you know, 100 organizations have merged their audience databases from extremely large, the opera, to really, really little. And, you know, when you break down that this is mine and you open it up, it becomes a really powerful way to reach people. But we need to wrap this up because we have to catch a plane. So I'm really, really, planes, various planes, and heading in different directions. Mark should tell you about how you can stay connected to the conversation.
Yeah, so it is our hope that this would not be the final word because, honestly, again, all we have is questions right now. And I feel like I've just learned a lot and have absorbed a lot of exciting stuff just listening for a few hours today, and we would like to keep this conversation going. So on Monday we're going to have our last of these meetings, and then sometime by the end of next week everyone who is here will receive an email from me, it will give you the link to a private page on TDF's magazine, which I edit, that will be just for people who participated in these conversations, and there is a system in place where we can continue to talk to each other. And you have to have the password to get in, so it's going to feel, hopefully, like we're not throwing it out to all 7 billion people on the earth who clearly want to read this kind of stuff. You know, that the idea is that it's a place to, if there are still ideas that you want to think through, things that you didn't say today that you think, oh, I wish I'd said that, or on Sunday or Monday, you're like, oh, I wish I'd said that, please come to this site, and we want to try to start inviting all, we want to just keep it going, because, again, there's no answer to these questions, really. There's just only better ways of asking them, and we have to just keep asking and asking and refining and refining, and it would be great to have all of your voices continue on.
And when it comes time to survey audiences and talk to them, you guys are the only ones who can get to them. Right? We can't, so we'll be back to colleagues.
Thanks to all of you for spending so much time on this today, and to Jeremy and everyone at the Playwrights Center for hosting us.
Thank you.
Thanks, all.